Today's featured guest, Jeffrey Nichols from Roslyn Capital.
By now, I'm sure our listeners know that Donald Trump is the 45th president of the United States. It was nearly a landslide victory in the Electoral College, where he surprised pundits early this morning with a marginal victory in Pennsylvania that secured 20 votes. U.S. equities sold off sharply, as expected, and safe haven assets benefited, including the cryptocurrency Bitcoin, which gained 3%. Joining me in this discussion, Jeffrey Nichols from Roslyn Capital.
Well, Chris, it's good to be here with you today, particularly at this historic moment in the nation's economic and political future. The election results, I think, underscore the importance of gold as an investment and particularly as a safe haven with good price prospects in the years to come.
I share your sentiments, and I think it's really underscored by the turnaround or the sea change event that we saw in the last 24 hours. I mean, virtually all the major polls were virtually unanimous, just like the Brexit episode that just stunned the markets, as well as, I think, people around the world.
Here, you know, the Brexit and the U.S. results overnight, I think, underscore a global trend towards more protectionist, populist tendencies in both the major European countries and the United States, and probably if you take a look at the Asian markets, you'll probably see a similar tendency towards protectionism and populism at the same time. And that, I think, is one of the reasons why gold should benefit from this turn of events. First of all, we have tremendous increase, I think, or recognition of uncertainty in financial markets. And if there's one thing that gold thrives on, it's uncertainty. And we're likely to have not only uncertainty for the moment, but uncertainty for at least the next few years. We don't know what Donald Trump really represents in terms of economic and social and political policies. That's yet to be discovered. He's expressed many views on many things, some of them contradictory. So we have to just see how he's going to sort out his priorities and what type of policies he's going to pursue. And we just don't know the answer to that question yet. I expect markets will react with the same sort of volatility that we've seen in the last day or two.
Is there anything else that you'd like to discuss with regard to the presidential election outcome and the ramifications and potential reverberations that might be felt throughout the markets before we move on to other topicality?
Let's just sort of bullet point some of the main issues and sources of uncertainty that now appear more likely as a consequence of the election. First off, we're likely to see greater volatility in foreign exchange markets, with the dollar going up and down with more force and vigor than it otherwise would. It's going to increase interest in gold amongst some investors, not only as a safe haven, but as a currency that is free from political maneuvering. And I think that's why many people like to hold some gold in their portfolios, because it just does reduce that sort of risk positive for gold, not just in the near term, but probably for the next few years at least.
Exactly. And there just really are question marks about the safety, security of financial instruments. As I mentioned, cryptocurrencies getting quite a nice bump after the election outcome. And that has been a theme. You know, after Hugo Chavez, the latest president, Maduro, doesn't seem to have a handle on the economy. Venezuelans now are facing the opening salvo of hyperinflation. One article showed a carton of eggs, 12 eggs, cost approximately $150 US. Price explosion due to the bolivar's depreciation, and they just don't seem to have a plan that can work.
Well, I would just make the general comment that it illustrates how gold can protect against the erosion of value in currencies, whether it's the Venezuelan currency or someday it may be the U.S. currency. You know, we've had really over the last several years a very expansionary and inflationary monetary policy. We've had seen the creation of billions of dollars, literally, in dollars by the Fed and the printing presses. And ultimately, that's going to come home to roost in terms of higher prices for consumers throughout the economy.
Talking about higher prices, potentially a 20,000 bolivar note or bill, if you will. Grocers and storekeepers will not accept bolivars at face value. They only accept bags of bolivars, which they promptly weigh and then give an estimate of the potential value.
Reminiscent of the German hyperinflation in the early 1900s when people were running around to stores looking for food and other necessities with wheelbarrows full of Reichmarks.
The $100 bolivar note is now comparable to a dime or a 10-cent piece here in the United States. And this just really unfolded 12 to 24 months, depending on what you choose as your starting point.
Flames of inflation in Venezuela were stoked much earlier when the country was really under communist leadership, was promoting social change, which seemed like a good idea at the time, but undermined the currency in the longer run and had laid the groundwork for the problems the country is now having.
It sort of outlines just how quickly that the specter of runaway prices can emerge in almost any economy. And Venezuela has long been viewed as the gem of South America. They face this atrocity that just eviscerates the middle class. And the only real solid asset that seems to have protected anyone other than cryptocurrencies are the metals and real tangible goods.
Really, that we're not going to see a hyperinflation of the sort we have in Venezuela now or that we had decades ago in Germany. But nevertheless, there will be rising inflation and rising inflation expectations, a consequence of the monetary and fiscal policies of the last several years. And we're beginning to see that already. I mean, one reason stock prices are so high and real estate values are so high is because the creation of money, while it hasn't flowed yet into consumer goods, but it has been fueling inflation in certain asset markets, equities and real estate come to mind. And when the confidence in the government's ability to manage the economy diminishes, I think we'll see these other asset markets sell off, and that monetary creation that's taken place over the last several years will express itself in terms of higher consumer prices affecting all of us. I'm probably among the more bullish in terms of price prospects for gold and other precious metals. And I think it's important to understand that it doesn't depend solely or entirely on U.S. economic and political developments. But remember, gold is traded and priced in a global market, and what happens outside the United States can be just as important, if not more important, than what happens inside the United States. And my feeling is that we're going to see continued strong demand for gold in the Asian economies, particularly India and China, both of which, for different reasons, have historic interest and attraction to gold as a medium for savings, long-term savings. And when people in those countries buy gold, it often will never come back to the gold market. It's a subtraction in the available supply of metal. When we see higher demand come from the United States, all this money that's gone into gold in China and India is going to, in a sense, come home to roost.
once the elemental crosses China's borders, it truly enters the event horizon and rarely reemerges. The singularity, of course, is the result, at least partially, of the PBOC and government regulations on the export.
It's against the law to export gold from China, but it's perfectly legal to import it. And so we've had a net flow of gold into China that's never going to come out to the world market again, not in our lifetimes at any rate.
Of course, China, like the United States, interestingly, I'm going to make the parallel here, has a history with silver as the backing for its currency, a silver-backed currency. It'll be interesting to see whether or not that changes. And if it were to change, I think we would see a surprising increase in demand for silver.
Could very well be. But for now, the interest really is in gold. And it's not just the private sector, which is buying more gold, but the official sector in the form of the central bank, which month in and month out is buying 15 to 20 tons a month, is continuing to do so. And interestingly, it's the other communist country, Russia, which is doing the same thing. And I think this represents an effort by government authorities in those two countries to reduce their reliance on the U.S. dollar as a reserve asset and enhance their own currency's prospects to serve as a reserve asset in however the world monetary order sorts itself out in the next few years.
I would only add that I think these moves that you've outlined here almost lend themselves to a scenario where silver becomes almost invaluable relative to its current price, because as the central bankers and the powers that be, and you know, obviously the PBOC, continue to accumulate in India as well, let's not forget, massive amounts, eventually, you know, 2 to 4 billion people in the periphery who just cannot procure gold simply due to the cost, which I think could make silver absolutely a must-have asset.
Exactly.
Okay, let's move on to the latest Labor Department report. We saw another robust jobs number. It wasn't enough to impress investors, even with their 191,000 revision from the following month, and the drop in the overall national employment rate down to 4.9% from 5%. Just wasn't enough to excite the markets. I mean, clearly, folks are starting to realize we've had this at least official recovery from approximately 10% unemployment down to sub 5% levels. And I'm starting to think that contrarian and institutional deep pocket investors recognize, you know, where do we go from here? Can this downward trend persist after such a long period? Are we at the, you know, the nadir of the cycle and a higher unemployment and recession is in our future?
The unemployment rate, as it's published, is only part of the story. The labor markets have been unable to benefit a whole swath of workers who have lost their jobs over the last decade and have subsequently dropped out of the labor force because they don't see any opportunities for themselves. We're talking about millions of people who have, in a sense, been left out of the economic expansion that we've seen in the last few years. This is one of the reasons why Donald Trump has done well, because he's appealed to this disaffected millions of workers who remain unemployed and have little hope of finding a job. Monetary policy is also sensitive to that issue and has been leaning towards low interest rate policies and reflationary policies as a consequence.
What you just outlined is probably the deciding factor in the presidential elections in the last 24 hours. In fact, in the exit polls, you may have read, it was the number one, I believe, issue. Jobless rate. I mean, we essentially have 100 million able-bodied Americans, or let's just say working-aged Americans, who are capable of meaningful work, who are having difficulty finding it or have given up altogether.
I think that there's a whole array of issues that will result in the Fed pursuing low interest rate, high monetary stimulus policies for some time to come. As you mentioned earlier, there had been talk of an imminent interest rate increase by the Fed this December. But I think given the results of the presidential election and the uncertainty of economic situation as a result of the election, the Fed is likely to undertake continued stimulus for longer and not raise interest rates as fast as they otherwise might in the next year because of uncertainty about the U.S. economy, fear of toppling it into a worse recession than we may already have at our heels.
No, exactly. Our analysis jibes. It aligns perfectly with your thoughts there. While I do suspect there's still higher than average odds that we will see an interest rate hike to 75 basis points on the the overnight lending rate in December, and we've been calling it for many months, there's just no hint of any rate hikes in 2017. I don't think we'll see it. We'll likely see the Fed's balance sheet, which has essentially been flat now for a year or two, increase in the coming years to offset uncertainty and volatility in the economy.
It wouldn't surprise me, in fact, if we see a sharp decline in Wall Street equity prices, see the Fed actually intervene in the stock market in addition to prop up asset prices for equity investors.
We've heard recently from Jim Rickards, who's been calling for $10,000 gold. Actually helped with the long-term capital management bailout, you might recall, in 1998, as well as helped officials in 2008. He sees something even more horrendous on the horizon and has revised his $10,000 target to $50,000. Do you think there might be some substance to some of these targets?
Well, I don't think any of us really know how high gold may go as it moves higher in the next few years. But I think we can be fairly confident to say that it's going to move up substantially. I myself think we're going to see prices for gold more than double in the next few years. The upside potential is certainly more significant than most observers outside of Jim Rickards believe, in part because of what we talked about a few minutes ago, demand coming from the big Asian markets of India and China, which is not really factored into price prospects. In the wake of the Trump election victory, we are already seeing increased uncertainty in financial markets, and that spells higher gold in the weeks and months ahead.
The dollar has sold off sharply. If this trend continues, it could break the back of the two-year consolidation, which would support your thesis of a new uptrend in the precious metals, mm-hmm. because this, as you, I think, really alluded to early in our discussion, is a currency story, at least for the most part, tied to global currencies. And we haven't discussed this, but in terms of most major global currencies, gold is near relative highs in recent months, whereas with only the greenback, I think you'd agree, maybe the yen, we've seen some stubbornness. So this election just might be what precious metals aficionados needed for a happy new year.
Well, let's just say we have interesting times ahead. Your readers should remember that I'm senior economic advisor to Roslyn Capital, which is a retail gold investment firm that I highly recommend for those who are looking to increase their, or initiate, I should say, as well, their precious metals holdings. Well, I just suggest they give Roslyn Capital a call and begin a discussion on the how-tos and such of holding gold, whether it be in their overall portfolio or their IRA and retirement accounts. I have always advocated that there's a place for gold in every investor's toolkit, and that 5 to 10% of investable assets should be held in gold as a insurance policy against the various risks we've been talking about.
You know, I think that's just really the key. We experienced a very strong downdraft, but it really balances U.S. equities particularly very well in a portfolio. So the point there is when you have a big down day in the U.S. equities markets, as we're seeing today and recently, for the most part, the precious metals tend to offset that loss.
You know, also, I would say that investors should own gold and hope that it doesn't go up. And it doesn't go up, it means that the rest of their investment assets, the other 80 or 90% of their investment assets, are doing great. And that's what we should really hope for. But prudence dictates that we have some insurance in case we're wrong. That insurance is in the form of some physical gold, as I said, 5 to 10%
right.
of investable assets is what we typically talk about.
Yeah, it's well said. And I would only add, during unusual times, during strong themes, as we're seeing in the precious metals, not just in the United States, but, you know, around the globally as well, you can increase your allocation. You can comfortably do so. It's prudent. It's wise. Well, we thank you for your time and look forward to having you back on Gold Seek Radio.
My pleasure.
The gold and silver mining sector is red hot. Every investment portfolio needs precious metal shares. GoldSeek.com's top stock analysts have done it again, identifying the next solid gold nugget opportunity, Brazil Resources. Based in the eighth largest economy with a mining-friendly reputation, almost 10 million ounces of gold reserves, industry insiders are accumulating shares of Brazil Resources. The notable management team includes Chairman Amir Adnani, a rising star in the mining industry with a reputation for moving projects rapidly into production. Fortune magazine lists Chairman Adnani in the prestigious list of 40 under 40 ones to watch. Plus, shareholders benefit from the insights and backing of enigmatic Brazilian billionaire Mario Garneiro, CEO of Brazil Invest Group, the nation's foremost merchant and investment bank, and founding director. Their São Jorge project is 100% owned with paved highway access, a nearby workforce, and a hydroelectric power source near the major gold deposits. Their next top project includes three deposits identified by major gold producers, plus their RIA project, which is a joint venture with Areva, benefits from a $10 million treasure map in the hottest address for uranium production in Canada. But the story gets even more exciting with their Whistler project, offering geographic diversification in South Central Alaska. To find out more about this unique opportunity, please direct your web browsers to BrazilResources.com. At Yahoo Finance, ticker symbol BRI.V. Remember, to ride the exciting gold stock run of 2016 and beyond, your portfolio will thank you for adding shares of Brazil Resources.
Gold Seek employees may or may not own shares. Nothing contained herein should be construed as investment advice.